So here we are in the George Eastman house, now known as the George Eastman Museum. This is where Mr. Kodak lived and worked. And we have been invited to the Kodak Technology Vault. And that's where we're going right now and take you to see some of the camera history of the world.
So, I mean, do you want to start with the beginning, or?
just
in the beginning, there was film?
Yeah, in the beginning, well, was there film in the beginning? No. More glass.
Well, or, we can go. Let's go to a daguerreotype here.
Let's have a quick look at the daguerreotypes. Okay. So, how big is this place?
Count-wise or size-wise?
Well, I've read that it's about 73,000 something square feet.
This particular vault is 50 by 100 feet, okay. Two stories.
Oh, this is just one of them.
Yeah, this is just one vault. We have multiple vaults here. The photos are on the other side of the wall. So we're photography soup to nuts, you know.
Oh, I understand.
So we do have a Giroux daguerreotype camera that's on display in the gallery. Uh-huh. However, what we have here is what's usually considered to be the oldest known camera sold in the U.S. Mm-hmm. And when I say known, we have the receipt for it. It was purchased by Samuel Bemis from Francois Gouraud, who is Daguerre's agent in the States. This is a digital copy, by the way. The real one's up in our rare book collection. It was purchased on April 15th of 1840 for $76.
Wow, that's quite a bit of money.
It came with 24 plates. There's also a $2 handling charge, which we like. You got to pay the handler.
Of course.
And so it's this trunk. It's a complete kit. So apparently all the ones that were sold in this country came this way. This
is the complete kit means including everything you need to develop it.
It's the camera. The sensitizing box, the developing box, and 24 plates. And this is actually one of the plates. This is a full-size daguerreotype plate. You can see it's a copper that's been coated with metallic silver on one side. You may.
Careful. Whoa, history in my hands.
History in your hands.
Wow.
And so, of course, you know, to make these plates, you've got the silver from the metallic silver on the one side here. The copper is supported to be very thin silver. Would have been hammered on, by the way, rolled on. It's not electroplating. That didn't exist in the 1840s.
And there was a lot of polishing involved.
Well, no, actually, the original process, you cleaned the plate. Polishing came later. You cleaned the plate. It'd be treated with iodine, exposed for about 15 minutes in the camera.
Really?
And then processed with mercury vapor. This is the holder. There's very few holders known.
It wasn't a very healthy process.
Well, they didn't know that at the time. So.
True.
So yeah, that's the original process. Now, there were improvements done to it. When you get into polishing, in reality, most of the daguerreotypes that people are familiar with would be not this process. It would be the new and improved, if you would, process.
That are very, very pristine, very...
Yeah, they started polishing the plate, and actually determines the contrast.
All right.
And they also would have been double sensitized plates, which really shortens the exposure time. So faster lenses, better process.
How short were the exposure times? Short.
On a nice sunny day like today, we've had people come here and make them. You're talking somewhere around, I would say, in the... It's really, because it's view V and it's hard to measure. Probably in the 5 to 15 second range.
So that's fast.
Yeah,
okay.
It becomes that fast. It really is.
But it comes down to UV radiation.
It's UV, yeah, because this is sensitive to blue and UV. So it's both wet plate and daguerreotype, once you get an improved daguerreotype process, the exposure times are very similar.
All right.
Okay, so that's that. And so we've mentioned a little bit of wet plate. Well, I guess we can show you some wet plate things. Oh yeah, yeah. Tin types or any things along those lines. Now, the complete kit's really nice to see.
And you need a porter for it.
Yeah, that whole outfit weighs about 75 pounds. Sorry, I'm in America and I'm not going to give you kilos.
Totally
you
can carry. Okay. Did it come with wheels?
It didn't. I think it came with a Sherpa. No, you had to transport it yourself. It's pretty heavy.
All right.
So when you get into wet plate, all sorts of different things. Probably the best one to look at is going to be the Disdari CDV camera, which is, see if I guess the right cabinet here.
So how many cameras do you have in here?
Oh, there's about 8,500 cameras in here. So,
put some work in. I think we have about 30 to 60 cameras back home.
Well, none of this quite.
You have a few more to go then.
Yes.
So these are all kind of wet plate stuff here, more or less. if you ignore the Niepce camera there, which is another one. Well, here, we're here.
These for Niepce.
Yeah, this one was acquired from his son, Isidore, his summer cottage. And it's an interesting camera. It's thought to be the world's first bellows camera. It's actually a metal frame bellows. If you go chart back what Niepce was doing, aside from trying to make, he's trying to make images to be reproduced in books is what he was working on. This is the father. And he'd also been working on a gasoline, or I should say a paraffin-fueled marine engine. Mm-hmm. And with kind of like air injection, they were using a bellows to induce air. So they were familiar with the bellows material to make a bellows camera, which is, you know, if you look at the first cameras, those are actually double boxes, two boxes.
Sliding.
So the bellows occupies the space where the second box is. It makes the camera collapsible.
Yeah.
And the thing about this camera that's interesting is it folds and can be really stored in the lower half of the box. Unfortunately, it does not have the original back, so I don't know exactly which process it was used for. Right. However, the flange is threaded on the outside, which is very unusual. It's the only flange I've ever seen that's threaded that way, and it's more typical as to what was done pre-photography with optical instruments. So it's this is conjecture, and you know, how far out there do I want to go on this? The real question is, okay, does this predate Isidore? Was this the camera that his father used? Does it predate the Daguerrotypie cameras that we have there? I say, well, gee, possibly, but I don't know. My leaning is kind of in that way, but I don't have anything to prove it. But the lens flange is certainly makes it very curious.
Interesting. So that's where the bellows originally came from.
And it's a metal framed bellows, by the way.
So in the bellows, there's
actually metal wires around each fold. So really quite
a process.
Very difficult to reproduce. But you know, if you think about it, and you're going to make something like that. If you look into the way bellows are manufactured, there's an outer material, there's actually an inner support, usually like a cardstock, there's a cloth liner. The cardstock is actually serving the same purpose that these metal frames do.
And they don't have to have that much structural integrity anyway,
It just has to hold it there. So aside from that camera, everything else in here is wet plate. Well, ignore that box.
Okay, we're not looking at that.
Don't look at that box. So we talked about the carte de visite, and so this is the Distary's carte de visite camera. And when we say CDV and Distary, we're actually talking about a format. It's a business card or visiting card size. Mm-hmm. It's really the equivalent of taking an 8x10 plate and cutting in fours.
And what, four frames at the same time.
So you could take four frames at a time, and actually what he did, this would be a repeating back camera, so actually it would be eight frames. Two sets of four.
And those back in the time were pretty mass produced, right?
They were intended to be traded.
Well, not replicated, but they would make them in larger quantities.
But you could share them sort of like, baseball cards, if you would. But what this camera established was the size. The size was adopted fairly quickly in the U.S. Not the camera, the size, for portraits of American Civil War soldiers.
I mean, to me, if you look at a business card today, in German, the German word for it is Visitenkarte.
Yeah, visiting.
So it is a carte de visite. It's pretty much the origin of that.
It's the same. So it really goes back to this guy right here. Now, as far as most images of that size were not made with this camera. And if you look at it and use a little bit of logic, what's the most expensive part of the camera?
In this case, probably the lens.
And he's got four of them instead of one. So what ended up happening is they'd take cameras with repeating backs that would make that same size.
Around.
Just slide the back around, yeah. Whether it's most commonly would be just two up instead of, in this case, eight. But we do have uncut sheets from made with this camera, which is really kind of interesting. So that's that one. And next to it is an English camera, also kind of interesting in the wet plate land. You'll notice that unlike the Niepce camera, this camera has a tapered bellows instead of being square. This uses the Kinnear patent, which actually had to do with, again, making the bellows taper. And what that does is when you fold the camera, the taper bellows actually allows the camera to be a little bit more compact when you fold it.
So it compresses better.
It also makes it harder to make the bellows because it's when you make these, it has habits of actually rotating because it has to be folded in a very specific way. But again, it makes the camera a little bit smaller.
I still need to find out how to make those because I have a project coming up.
Good luck.
Yeah, I know. It's not easy.
And the complicated thing about that is there used to be two businesses that would make bellows, and I believe they're both gone.
I know that too.
So trying to find bellows
is
pretty complicated. I believe there's a gentleman in Australia that's doing it, but I don't know if he's doing it for other people. I know can do it. I've heard
of
him.
I'd love to get his name if you can.
We can talk offline, and I can possibly supply that for you.
Thank you.
So to really tell the story, you know, seeing we're at George Eastman House, we had to tell a little bit of George Eastman lore to go with this. George Eastman was one of the first manufacturers of gelatin dry plates. He actually patented a machine that would mass produce them.
We're talking dry plates on glass.
Dry plates on glass. So the sensitized materials that would glass is the support. Mm-hmm. You know, these days, so like in the case of the daguerreotype, it was actually a copper plate that was coated with metallic silver. In the case of wet plate photography, you're using, again, window glass. They used collodion, which is gun cotton dissolved in ether. That was sort of the glue that held the silver sensitized materials onto the glass. But it had to be done wet. So, I mean, it was a very good process, created lots of good images, but it's kind of, I don't know, inconvenient.
It's time sensitive.
You've got to use it. Well,
they have like 5 minutes, right, to take the photo.
They actually had dry collodion, but it was very slow. But so the idea of being able to pre-manufacture, if you would, images had been around for a while. Yeah. Eastman, I mean, to make a long story short, he was going to invest in some land in Santo Domingo. He'd have to have this photographed. So he'd have to hire a photographer or go to do it himself. So he decided to study photography with the local photographer, George Monroe. He actually got more interested in photography, and he started reading some of the European journals, going back to, you know, England, about how to make dry plates, and decided to design a machine that could mass produce them. That's really the beginning of the Eastman dry plate company that opened in 1880. These are cameras that would have used those pre-manufactured plates. And this is a big game changer. I mean, before 1880, the concept of an amateur photographer, somebody who wasn't doing this to try to earn a living, because again, when you...
Wasn't there, yeah.
I mean, there are professional photographers who do this to try to earn a living, but that's another story. It really changes the game. And so suddenly, as soon as you have a new sensitized materials, again, you can buy them pre-sensitized. So now all you have to do is process them, or con a photographer to do that for you. So they start building cameras that are specifically designed for amateur photographers. They're generally called detective cameras, which is really kind of misleading. These were handheld cameras. They don't generally have a bellows in them. They don't sit on a tripod. So they're basically something you can pretty much hold up and go point, click.
And they're fixed focus.
Fixed focus. Well, some of them are a little more, but they're pretty simple box.
These are pretty much the precursors to the box cameras.
Right. This is what ends up, if you would, these sort of evolved into the Kodak and then the Brownie. So that's what we have here. Pretty rare when you really get into it. And some of them are a little fancier than others. You've got some nice woodworking here. This is called the Antique Oak Detective Camera, right?
It's a detective camera.
But it's, again, very typical of what you're looking at. And it's going to...
Would you still be focusing on a ground glass?
You're going to focus on a ground glass. Mm-hmm. Put your plate in a holder. Very similar to using a view mm-hmm. camera, but it's a box.
Yep.
Simple to use. They came in... At this time, we're still talking contact prints, so the size of the negative, you know, is going to be the size of the finished print for the most part. Enlarging was possible... The biggest problem with enlarging is coming up with a light source that's dependable. You know, if we take into account we have electricity and electric lights, but they didn't necessarily have that at this time.
Even if I think it wasn't really steady.
Steady. Well, they could actually. What they were using was this, originally they used sunlight, but the sun has this unfortunate habit of moving,
and so
does the earth. So yeah, things happen. So contact printing was really the way to go. Different sizes. And some of them are kind of interesting inside. This one looks like a parcel, hence the detective name. There's the lens hidden behind this little flap here.
Can you spin that around for me?
Oh, I showed the wrong person. Show the camera. There we go. That's the shutter mechanism. And the camera actually hides inside here. And there it is.
There it is, with a bellows.
With a bellows in this case.
So that could be focused.
This one could be focused. This is a little bit more elaborate, if you would, over most of them. And this has a nice leather covering and a handle that I won't pick up because we work in museums and we like leaving handles on packages.
Yes.
It's the old museum lore. If you pick it up by the handle, you'll have a handle in your hand and a camera on the floor, which is not a good thing.
I have a few of these cameras back home.
Flat.
Oops. Yeah.
Well, they were probably perfectly fine when they were made in the 1880s, but that was, more than 100 years from now, and it tends to dry out. And you can see this is pretty typical of what happens to leather right there. So that's a little bit of dry plate. So now we want to look at roll film in the Kodak, I guess, right?
It's continuing the history. Yes, that's a good idea.
Okay, so let's run over to the first aisle. I can show you a Kodak that still has film in it.
Oh, while we're walking here, sure. Is there any piece in here that would be your favorite?
My favorite camera.
Is there one favorite that you have?
Oh, I don't know. Here we go.
Can you single out one?
Well,
oh, look at this.
This is one of those curious things. It looks like a Brownie box camera, if you would. This is a piece from Gabriel Cromer's collection. He was one of the first collectors of cameras. It technically is not a camera. It's a piece for amusement. But if you lift off the front, you can see that it has a pig inside. So why is, I don't know. I just think it's rather...
It's just a joke.
It's a fun thing to have. So is this my favorite camera? No, but I really like it.
Okay.
It's not typically what one would think of when you come in here. And also, this guy right here, this is a pinhole X-ray camera from the University of Rochester Laser Lab. This used film in the 35mm cassettes, actually X-ray film, and they're using this to photograph particle collisions. So seeing you're photographing the what would come out when you collide things. We've always said this is the world's fastest camera because you can't really go any faster than the speed of light, which is what you have here. So
again, kind of pinhole cameras, never seen an X-ray pinhole camera.
So we've gone from a camera that has a pig inside to one that's
good.
Yeah, there you go. Pig in a poke. How about gold Leicas? White gold Leicas?
Okie dokie. Now we have...
This is actually a replica.
Edition.
This is a replica, actually.
I can't grab it and run. Okay.
You can't. Oh. No, it's
it's a replica.
But it's a very nice replica. Yeah. The original Leica came out in 1925. They made some exotic coverings on them, gold plated. I think they made probably about a dozen of them or so.
Yeah.
The real ones would be worth, I don't know, $3+ million. This is a very well done. And they're nice enough to leave the original serial number, so they're not trying to fool anybody. This was a very nice collector who gave us this collection. Now, we do have an O-series up in the History of Photography gallery, but it's locked away right now because we're upgrading it. So,
But with a 35mm, we're jumping an entire part of the history.
Right.
So
we're out of order, but...
So, it's okay. I don't even think we'll have to edit it.
We can fix that here. We can fix that real quick. So a little bit of just run of history of photography here.
Man, you have everything. Is this the biggest collection in the world?
I wouldn't say it's the biggest. I had a conversation like this with a gentleman who was aware of a museum that's forming in Virginia, and they said, well, you guys only have 200 brownies. We have 400. So I say, well, but do you have this one? So it's not so much quantity, although we've got a nice quantity.
Do you have the brownie quality. Christmas ornaments? We have eight of them on our Christmas tree.
We have some. This is the Kodak camera. That's
Kodak.
What it was named. It's called the Kodak.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Eastman started making gelatin dry plates 1880, evolved into making a paper-supported negative film in 1884, similar to calotype stuff.
Yep.
1885, he came out with what they called Eastman's American film, which actually is paper-supported stripping film.
When did the switch happen from collodion to gelatin?
About 1880.
1880.
Yeah,
so
I mean, officially.
Already
yeah,
there,
as far as commercially goes. There are people who were making gelatin dry plates
and
in the 1860s.
And they haven't found a replacement for gelatin, even up to now.
We have a replacement for gelatin.
It's digital.
It's going to show you what it is. It's one of these, but... The thing what gelatin does, that's again, it's the glue that binds it together. So when Eastman's getting into making a flexible film,
right.
They had transparent plastics at the time. The problem was to try to come up with some way to bind the sensitized material to the plastic.
To have it in a
get
good,
along.
Good emulsion, yeah, and then you need water to be able to penetrate it, right?
But not wash it away. There's lots of little funny qualities about film.
Yeah.
And actually, one thing I didn't get into with the daguerreotype, it's unusual in that the image and the daguerreotype is actually on the surface of the plate.
Oh, where the rest right. Doesn't have any depth.
It's not depth. Whereas you get into these other things, it's actually on or instead of on, if you would. It's a very complicated thing to do. So what Eastman originally did was create something they called a paperbacked stripping film. This is American film. And initially, I mean, the trouble with using paper as negatives, like Talbot had done, is you're actually printing through the paper.
It's not easy.
And it leaves the fibers of the paper show up. You get a soft image. So Eastman originally came up with an idea that we'll use the paper to support. We'll take the image off of that, put it on glass, make the print, and then we'll transfer it to another material, another transparent stuff, not light sensitive, as for storage. And he came out with this system. In 1885, he had roll holders that would fit other companies' cameras. There's nothing wrong with it, except the photographers, they're an odd lot. They didn't like processing it. They thought it was too difficult, too fiddly. And when you think about the extra steps, instead of just taking out processing it, it has the advantage of being lightweight, but it was a pain in the neck to process. So Eastman sort of, I don't know, that you can envision that Eureka light bulb coming on and said, well, wait a minute, okay, I have an idea. I'm barking up the wrong tree here. The heck with dealing with professionals, they're not going to change.
Yeah.
Let's come up with a product that's specifically for the amateur.
This one.
And we'll do the processing. That's really the key. Because mm-hmm. that removes the chemistry. So suddenly, instead of having to sensitize and like wet plate, And gelatin's dry plate solves that, but also we'll do the processing means that right. suddenly the chemistry has been removed from photography. So now all you have to do basically make it convenient. You basically cock the string and that takes the picture. And by the way, this is a camera from 1888. Not bad, it still works.
What's the shutter speed?
It's about 25th of a second or something like that.
As most box cameras, yeah.
Something around in there. And again, the film is going to be slow. I constantly get asked, you know, what was the speed? And it's going to be somewhere around ISO, I don't know, 2 to 3, something like that. But here it is. This is the roll holder. That's the film.
Okay.
It came with a length of film for 100 exposures.
Now, let me ask you a question. The round window, what is the reason for that? Because the image circle is bigger than that. I mean, or did it
just not cover
this?
The
this is
thing?
Pretty much just covering that circle.
All right, so that was pretty much a technical reason. Make it round and then develop that into a bit of a style.
They're trying to come up with it. They're trying to sell this at a cost. These cameras were pretty expensive, but this was a cost saving measure.
I see.
These cameras sold for $25 in 1888, which was a lot of money. Film processing and reloading was an additional $10. So he's pretty much solved it here.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it has its limitations, but...
Is that the roll film format? This is a 620?
This is 70 millimeter wide film, which is really the equivalent of 120. And 70 millimeter, if you do some math, we kind of quickly looked at a Leica, what's half of 70? 35 millimeters.
Yeah.
This camera comes out with its film. Let's see. Initially, we're talking American stripping film, right? The next year, 1889... he comes out with nitrate film. That was the final, you know, success of being able to mount it on something that you can print through that gets along, so to speak. That this also happens to be about the same time that Thomas Edison's research assistant, W.K.L. Dixon, is investigating the kinetoscope motion pictures. They've been trying to make their own film. They couldn't do it. They found out about this stuff. They had Eastman slit it and perforate it for them. So suddenly we have 35 millimeter motion picture film. So it really goes back to this guy
right here. Simple to make, because you already have the size.
And again, why make it yourself if you can buy it from somebody who's already doing it?
Sure.
So this camera is not only the beginning of snapshot photography as we know it today, but it also represents the beginning of the motion picture industry. It contains the main ingredient, if you would, the film that was necessary.
Great. But with the low ISOs, you needed a bit of light.
Yeah, that's the one problem. I mean, if from this time on, what happens with photography is ways to increase your picture-taking potential. Yeah. These cameras worked really great on a sunny day in the middle of the afternoon. It's an F9 lens. 20th of a second, so I can photograph anything moving.
Make sure you have the sun in your
back. That's right. with this camera came two things: the instructions how to use it, which consisted of lift the string, push, point, and he actually told you what to point it at, how to make good pictures, so to speak. There was a treatise on how to develop it also, but he's also he's telling you how to use the camera. What is worth photographing? What's a good picture? It comes into here.
Oh, it was new, so everyone had to learn. Yeah.
Well, and there's also a little bit of marketing here when you think about it from a business standpoint. And Eastman was a very good businessman. If people get good results, they're going to make more pictures.
Of course they
so
do.
We're going to sell them more film and more processing. So that all makes sense. But from this point on, it's trying to come up with more ways to use your camera.
Sure.
So if we add.
Can I hold this for a second?
Just don't drop it.
I'm not going to drop this.
Yeah.
481.
481. They made about 5,000 of these. Be very careful. Just gently lift it up. That's far enough.
And then point it at someone.
Well, it's a waist level. You're supposed to hold it against your chest,
and you see difficult.
And there's a V sight line. So anything in there.
Ah, I see. Okay.
And the other advantage of the round format, and if you think about this. If it's a round format and camera's slightly off kilter, we can straighten it when we make the picture.
True.
This is before Photoshop.
Oh, that is smart.
This is very well, thought out.
Yeah.
But very well made camera. As I said, this is 127 years old, still works.
So from there, when did the roll film with the paper backing arrive?
Well, the paper backing, we'll have to go down this way. Before we do this, if we look at this other little brass gizmo here, you'll see there's a line etched in it in the top, and there's another one in the bottom. Mm-hmm. That's actually for indexing, and to go from one frame to the next. When you think about this, you're going from a spool to a spool. You can't move at the same difference because the spools change. So you need to have an idler to keep track of that.
So that's a roller on the film?
It's a roller on the film, and actually it had two little nail points that would prick holes in the film, so when you get to process it, where the images are. Adding more parts to the camera to do that.
True.
Think about it. So, and the goal is to get the price
of
the camera down.
And I know where you're going with
this. You know where I'm going with this. I'll show you what happens next here in just one second. So if we go down the aisle, see if I can find what I'm looking for, and eureka, we found it. This guy right here. This was a product made by Blair Camera called the Bullseye. And what this does, it's basically very similar to the Kodak, except it has this little guy in the back, this window in the back. This little red window, if you put paper backing on the film, so you have the film and then you have a separate roll of paper, put numbers on those, that film, that paper is going to travel the same distance, so you can use that to index. Mm-hmm. Eastman really liked this idea. In fact, he liked it so much he bought the company.
Made things easier.
He ended up making his basically his same, same almost the same
similar,
camera. Right,
yeah.
Right. So that's 1895. They made about 55,000 of those in 1895. Well, that's a lot of cameras, especially when you realize these are mostly done by hand. Still pretty expensive. The Pocket Kodak, which is a smaller version, sold for about $5. These were about $7. However, the real solution to this is this guy right here. This is the Brownie camera from 1900. In fact, this is basically from the first month's production. It has a slightly different back design, but you'll see it still has the little red window on this. In fact, this one, like I said, this is from the first month's production. These cameras sold for $1. Roll of film was 15 cents. Processing was 40 cents. So we've been within 12 years, we've gone from $25 for the camera to $1. Uh-huh. We've gone from $10 for processing and reloading to about 55 cents.
So this must really have kicked off mass adoption.
This really did. This was a camera that was intended for children. It was to be an entry-level camera and intended for children with adult supervision, if you would. Still works, by the way. That's the shutter release right there. Click, click.
In both directions?
Yeah, both directions. It's
so back and forth, yeah.
There we go.
Yeah.
You also can do B if you pull a little lock out. But yeah, so suddenly, it's a camera that just about anybody can afford. Now, $1,900, that's probably more like, $20 today. You think, what is the cheapest camera you can buy? The one-time use cameras that usually sell for somewhere around town. It's that kind of area. So it's suddenly you've gone from really expensive to affordable. They sold 150,000 of these in 1 year. Over three times of that.
Would people still bring that back to get the film?
No, these were daylight loading. So it's the roll of film on the core, some of us old geezers are used to. Mm-hmm. Something called film. But yeah, so basically everything you think of today, the only real difference is the spool was made out of wood, with metal flanges on the ends. But for $1, and from here on out, again, we've lowered the cost to make it affordable. Yeah. Now we want to make it so you can use it any place.
Yeah.
And again, it gets into better results. You're going to take more
film
pictures.
Speeds are better
film
at that
speeds
time,
are going to go up. Lots of things are going to happen from here on out. But now we've taken something that was certainly very difficult to do for the common person. We've made it easy, and now we're going to increase their potential. So we add, faster lenses, faster films, artificial flash type lighting, automatic exposure. These all come within the next, say, 40 years.
Right. So when did the German competition, the Agfas and other boxes, start to come in? That was later.
Yeah, the Brownie, obviously I'd showed you their box cameras before.
Yeah.
The Brownie is so successful that just about every company that made cameras would make a box camera.
They pretty much
everybody
ripped off the design.
Yeah, there are companies that made one. One of my favorite ones is the Buster Brown, because this was named after a children's cartoon character.
Okay.
Buster Brown, that's Ansco, company Ansco. Within a couple of years, again, just about everybody made them. So they'd be slightly different, or some, depending on how much patent law you want to ignore, would make just a complete copy.
Yeah.
And this is made out of cardstock, but it's pretty well made, a reasonably decent camera, and the images were pretty good. I mean, the images are going to rival the Kodak.
Yeah.
So from this standpoint, as far as Eastman Kodak companies,
one single meniscus lens in there.
It's a single meniscus. Yeah.
Yeah.
The Kodak actually has a little bit better lens and a better objective, again, for the price, getting the price down, cheaper materials.
Sure.
These are still largely handmade. The way they got the production up was to actually just hire more people to make them.
No, just lens materials. It was glass till quite late.
Yeah, these had glass.
When did they start to get transparent plastics that were optically
good? Oh, it's really
enough.
Getting into the 1950s for that.
That late, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at camera production, there was quite a bit of handwork done on them. Really is late into the 1960s. The Instamatic cartridge ushers in the big change. And it's the fact that you're able to, this is the Instamatic right here, well, they sold over 75 million of these. So pretty amazing numbers when you get into it.
Yeah, my dad had one of those.
Everybody had one of these. Being able to come up with the light tight cartridge that will accurately place the film in the focus point in the camera.
And
it's pretty amazing.
And still using backing paper.
And still using backing paper, because that's the cheapest way. Fewer parts.
Yeah.
Fewer parts is really
no
key.
No counter.
And you know, the thing about this, and I didn't realize this, I mean, I had one of these. People thought, well, what's wrong with them? You get the pictures back, they're not always really sharp. They tried to blame it on the cartridge. No, it's bad processing, actually.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. When they were doing investigations into the disc, they looked at other formats, and they were hand processed and hand enlarged. I actually knew the gentleman who worked on this, and he said, you know, they were all blown away the quality that came out of this. Well, sure, the film's bigger for one thing, but it was the fact that the photo finishing labs got sloppy.
The film itself was always sharp. Or as sharp as
I mean, it's not going to hold it perfectly flat, but you know,
flat enough.
Depth of field that you're going to get out of lens. Again, this is around an F9. They didn't really change that. I mean, they sold ones with better lenses.
Wow.
But,
price point.
It's a price point. And again, the money was, they didn't lose money on cameras, I don't believe, but they certainly made a lot more money on film and processing than they did on the cameras.
I know a few other companies that have that model.
It's a pretty good model. Yes. It's a very successful model for a long period of time. So I mentioned automatic exposure. We're probably going to do these out of order. Yeah. This is the Super Kodak 620. This is the first camera for automatic exposure. And what they did is they manually or mechanically connected a galvanometer, it's a selenium cell galvanometer, to the aperture of the lens. Oh. So you'd select the shutter speed, and the lens would...
Selenium cell would have enough... Like, right. That was mechanically quite fragile, wasn't it?
Yeah, and they did it. And they did this in 1938, the Super 620. They made about 750 of these cameras. Not many of them made. And actually, more of them broke. I think they said they made 750 and repaired 2,000. They had a problem with the self-timer. The self-timer would lock up. But
rangefinder, yeah.
Has a rangefinder, couple of rangefinders, single window viewfinder. Oh, also wow. another. This is a very high-end camera.
Uh-huh.
These sold for about $250 in 1938, which is a lot of money. Mm-hmm. Fast lens, capable. At this time, the highest film speed was, I believe, 16. Mm-hmm. This is the other thing that people don't realize is how much film speeds have changed over there.
It's changed a lot.
And it's non-coated lens. The other advance that we're not really getting into yet is going to be color. And Eastman...
Color after 1950, 50-something?
Well, actually, the first...
I mean, color was earlier, but the mass...
Yeah,
color
stops being a scientific laboratory experiment, really, with the introduction of the Lumiere autochrome plates in 1903. Okay. Those are not true-to-nature color, but they're color-like. It's interesting, you randomly place colored dyed potato starch grains as a screen over the plate. Right. Very slow because you're adding a label to it. Eastman established his research labs in 1912 specifically in mind to come up with a color emulsion that would work.
So what was the point when color was like available to the masses as film?
Film? In this country it's Kodachrome. Yeah. Originally introduced as a 16 millimeter motion picture film in 1935. 36 they released it as 35 millimeter, right. And actually bigger sizes. People don't realize it was available up to probably about 11 by 14.
And then you ended up having problems with the older cameras that didn't have the lenses to correct for it,
right.
Or
and
the
actually,
other red window didn't work anymore.
Right, and Kodak actually was selling coated lenses. They just didn't tell anybody that they were until... a couple of other companies started saying, well, we have coated lenses. They said, well, we've already been doing it to account for the fact that we had color film.
Forgot to market it.
Why tell people? Well, they were soft coating, so they didn't coat the external element was the problem. But Kodak called it luminized. Again, it's as far as color in Europe, Agfa color, Agfa chrome, similar. Not Kodachrome is its own unique, weird little thing.
I do remember.
Kodachrome is a multi-layered black and white film where you actually, and there's actually a yellow filtering layer on here, where you're actually making color separations representing the primaries, and then you add the color and process it.
I've seen photos of the processing units, which I think the first ones were like almost the size of
pretty big.
Later, a bit smaller, yeah.
And the next thing that happens is during World War II, for aerial reconnaissance, they wanted color era reconnaissance. They wanted to be able to field process Kodachrome. And they say, well, you can't field process Kodachrome. So what came out of that actually was Kodacolor. And that's the salmon reversible negative film.
That's not C41. The C41 process?
C41, yes, C41.
Was that the C41 process,
yeah.
Pretty much? Okay.
It was released to the consumers in 47, and actually out of World War II, the various E6, it would have been E2 or whatever they're calling at the time, but the ektachrome type films.
But the reversal process.
Those originally were reversal with light, which I unfortunately had the pleasure of doing. Those actually came out of... World War II, stuff that was exported, if you would, from Germany after the war.
Right.
So that's why ektachrome and agfachrome and fujichrome are very similar type films.
Right.
They're all reversible, positive color films.
All right.
So what else are we lacking in the movie land? Amateur movies.
Amateur movies. What is that big lens?
That's an Erminox. Again, low light. Big lens, small camera. All right, this again, this is existing light photography. This is an F2, is it an F2 or 1.8? There are two versions of this.
And a crazy viewfinder.
And a crazy viewfinder. That's called a Newton finder. It's actually you use it about at arm level here.
Okay.
So pretty typical European finder.
Not like the old sports finders?
Instead of a frame finder, it has a glass in it, so it's a little better. But then we get into single lens reflex cameras, if you would. The beginnings of these go back into here. The Soviet Sport is the first one, and or the...
The robot, what's it called,
That's a spring motor. Yeah, I've got those. The spring loaded camera I have is the Pascal. This is 1899.
That's interesting.
And what this does is you put roll film in it, you wind it all the way up, which is actually advancing the film to the end, and then you trip it as you go, it winds back.
So you wind it once and it has enough...
You wind it all the way from the supply to the take up,
so the spring
and that also winds the shutter
for
for the whole film. Kind of neat. And we have, here's the Simplex. This is the first full frame 35 millimeter camera.
Full frame. It's funny,
that
we call it full frame now, right?
Well, this gets really confusing. Now, Simplex is a company that made motion picture projectors.
Yes.
And in the motion picture world, full frame is actually referring to a single frame of motion picture film, which is 18 by 24.
Yes, that's half format of the 35 millimeter format.
In still photography, a full frame is actually half frame. So this would be double frame.
And you know what 35 millimeters refer to in German? Kleinbild, small picture.
Small picture,
Because we come from this kind of a size. Or
The typical European pocket camera was a folding plate camera, and they tended to be 12 by 17, or they're fairly good size cameras, full plate, three and a quarter, four and a quarter, us non-metric types. Was it 12 by 18, something like that?
9 by 12,
pretty typical.
Centimeters was kind of the...
And really, the 35 millimeter hand camera, the Leica that we're looking at, Barnack had been working, his health wasn't great. He had asthma. He wanted to make a small pocket-sized camera.
Didn't want to carry something like that
in the mountains. So he started investigating, actually, in his before he even went to Leitz, he's working for Zeiss, actually, in the Microscope division. He made his first prototype that used leftover ends of 35 millimeter film, or Leica 1913.
That was cinema stock.
And he went with, again, this bigger size. The camera didn't really go anyplace until 1924. They made about 25 samples to be tested, usually called the O series Leica in this country, they call
ancient.
It the Null series Leica. The Ur Leica is the 1913 camera.
Right.
So the O series or the Null series is the 1924 camera, and eventually went into production in 1925 as the Leica A in Europe, the Leica 1 Model A in the U.S. We can't use the same numbers. It just makes makes my life confusing when I try to explain it to people. Same camera.
Same in the digital.
Different.
But what is the Rebel? Digital Rebel is KISS in Japan.
Yeah, that gets into the whole gray marketing stuff, it gets really confusing. Yeah. You know, the other thing that's really interesting is this guy right here. This is the Canon AE-1, pretty well-known camera, very successful camera. The thing that's interesting about this, from a historical standpoint, is this is the first camera that actually uses a computer chip. It uses a computer chip to actually control the self-timer, mind you, but it's the first computer
just
the self-timer, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Still being mechanical, it's a...
Well, that was at the time where people were quite worried about handing over control to something that needs a battery. I remember that very well.
Yeah,
people
batteries.
Like, okay, now needs batteries, and what happens if I run out of battery? Can I still shoot?
Right, which is why I can do this right here.
A hundredth of a second in there.
It still works, clunk. You know, and they also give you shutter speeds that go up to 1,000, which in reality it's not, because all the 1,000 speed does is it makes it so 500 would actually be a 500th.
Yeah.
A 1,000 speed, if you measure these, is probably going to be somewhere 650 to 750.
Oh, especially on the older shutter.
Older ones. But, you know, again, this is Nikon F.
Big measurement prisma, metering prisma.
Yeah, this is the Nikon F. One of the best-known photojournalist cameras comes out in 1959. It was made through 1973, virtually unchanged.
Wow.
Think about that in today's world. And it was a modular camera, so the meter was completely separate, slapped on the top. The link is external. There's a little prong pin that drops down into our arm that drops down into this prong.
Yep.
And again, batteries are a problem with this because you can't get this battery anymore. You can use a substitute, which kind of works.
Oh, the mercury batteries you can't use anymore.
Yeah, they don't quite put out the same voltage. It's a problem. But so I don't know.
So you
M3.
We went through the history pretty much from the start. Are there any pieces in here that are like that you say, wow, this is really cool, I want to show this? Doesn't matter if it's digital, analog, just anything that you would go, hey, you have to have a look at.
Okay,
this.
The first zoom lens, here we go. This is the Zoom R.
It's
trying to get us into things that we use today, right? Prior to this, if you're going to use you'd have to have a bag full of lenses. Now, optically, it's pretty complicated, not that good, but they're the first to do it. This is 1959.
Wow.
Let's see.
Volkländer, German.
There you go. How can you talk about photography without talking about the Rolleiflex? This is not the first twin lens reflex. Some of the actually dry plate cameras were twin lens. And what you're doing here is you're using a separate lens to view the subject versus taking it. And what it does in the case of portraiture is you never lose the sight of your subject.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, especially with a view camera, is really complicated because who knows what you're going to get.
And you're not pointing it straight at a subject because you're looking down, so it's less threatening.
And the other thing that's nice about this, when you think about it, it uses a square format. Because of the twin lenses, you don't have to turn the camera sideways. You just crop off the parts that you don't use. Not necessarily the most efficient way of using film, but it is certainly an easier way to build the camera. This comes out about 1929. This is the first model.
Yep, the first analog photo workshops I held were on the Rolleiflex premises. Wasn't much left of Rolleiflex back then, but history.
Oh, amateur motion pictures. You know, this is the Cine Kodak, 1923. I picked one that doesn't work.
This was the one you had to crank?
This would be the hand crank one, yes. This is the only one I have that doesn't work. The reason it's here is the original just had one viewfinder. It doesn't have the top viewfinder. But they took the film that they had for 35 millimeter, cut it in half, and put the perforations on the edges instead of in the middle, because actually half of 35 would be 17 and a half last time I checked. Other companies had used that. They found that having the perforation in the center of the frame tended to make the film break. So this is the beginning of a Cine Kodak 1923 16 millimeter film. And this actually came with a system. It came with a projector. So the camera and the projector and a screen and an editing system sold for about $500.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of money at the time, but this was really the beginning of home movies. Only hand camera, 1925. They come up with the Model B. So it's same camera. They made it smaller, but they've also added a spring motor to it, so you can
you crank it,
wind it up, and go.
And it still works.
Still works. Not bad for something from 1925.
Yep.
So that's certainly important. Flash bulbs. We didn't talk about flash.
Oh, yeah.
Another German product right here, the Vacuum Blitz. This is the first flash bulb. It's a glass bulb that's full of magnesium foil.
It's foil.
Foil were the first bulbs.
Isn't the mesh? It's in the
wire comes later. So the original was like this.
But were they also filled with oxygen and that would make them go faster?
Yeah, it ignites when you put a small electric charge into here.
Yeah. So this makes
indoor photography possible. And these are all things that we take for granted. It's all built into whatever camera you're carrying. You probably have all these little pieces in here. So you've got a flash, you've got automatic exposure, you have a zoom lens. So we just took all these little parts and just modern camera.
Mm-hmm.
But it took roughly 50 years to get there.
It's a long process, yeah.
Yep. Let's see, other things. Well, this is the oldest known digital single lens reflex camera. This is happens to be built on a Canon, and yes, this is kind of interesting. Eastman Kodak Company produced their first imaging sensor in 1986.
Right.
They made them. They weren't selling them.
Yeah.
A U.S. government agency, to remain nameless, you can probably guess, wanted to know if it'd be possible to put that sensor into a film camera, and they saw a gentleman named Jim McGarvey, Kodak engineer. took the Canon camera, that's what this particular agency was using, and they mounted their M1 sensor in it. So it really is a film camera with a digital sensor where the film would be, and it, tethered to it is a power supply and a memory card.
How much memory on that card?
Yeah, not a whole lot. But so this is first.
It's not a cassette as in the first in the blue one that we're
right, right.
Seen,
it was so it's actually is a memory circuit of some sort. Mm-hmm. As I said, this is the oldest one known. It's not the oldest one. They actually made one for this particular government agency, not as robust as this. That would have had a ribbon wired hard drive to it.
Okay.
So a little bit thinner. So they decided to make two more of these cameras, this is one of the two, to find out if this was an actual business to investigate. So this was called this was called Tactical Camera, dates from 1987-88. They continue the investigation. This is Hawkeye 2. They've taken that system and actually built it into something that would actually hold, in this case, a memory card that holds four pictures.
Wow.
Not compressed images, by the way. There's the sensor again.
So is that still a lab model, or was that was never commercialized?
No, this was never commercialized. They probably made maybe a half a dozen of these or so. And they switched to Nikon. They switched to Nikon bodies because that was the camera that most professionals used.
Yeah.
And they didn't call this a camera. They called it the Hawkeye 2 imaging accessory.
All right.
Because they didn't want to compete with film. They decided that the four pictures would be kind of, I don't know, not a very good solution. So they developed a slightly different version. It was tethered. Unfortunately, I don't have the tethered device for this. I know where there is one, but basically the same camera, but tethered. In 1991, this became an actual consumer product called the Kodak DCS. Mm-hmm. The press would name it the DCS 100 when the 200 came out. And what we have here is the, again, battery, memory card, and also has a playback unit, so you can actually see the image on the back of this little panel.
Wow.
These sold for about $25,000. They made about 900 of them. This is actually a second production run. The only difference would be this red band here. On the first version, they have the yellow one. I have those also. They also came in a rather large case. If you look on that shelf up there, you see that big gray suitcase. That's the case for it.
All right.
So about $25,000. The next year, they integrate it down to this size. This is the 200, hence that became named the 100. So they've been able to shrink it down, put a hard drive in here.
That's handy.
And would be handy. It was connected to a Macintosh, probably a 2CI, which I've been looking for, computer. And what happened next, actually, is the press decided that's a really good idea. Even though the cameras cost a lot of money, they're, like I said, $25,000, so Kodak. And you'll also notice that it says Kodak on here, bigger than Nikon. These were not made, you know, this was Kodak's camera built into a Nikon body. There was no agreement between Kodak and Nikon. They just bought the bodies and used them.
Oh, really?
Yep. So this is the AP-NC2000E. This was a deal between Eastman Kodak Company and Kodak. So all press photography in the U.S. basically was done with these cameras. It's a tuned-up version of the 200, and it has one really neat thing. You can actually take the hard drive out, portable hard drive.
Oh, okay. When was that?
Oh, this is 1992.
92, okay.
So we're coming up, believe it or not, on the 25th anniversary of digital photography for pros.
And now we're doing
just hard to believe. Yeah, that's all where it all comes from. And you think about it, these cameras, $25,000, that's a lot of money, but it's certainly cheaper to do that than it is to basically hire planes to fly your film back to
faster.
Get it faster. And it's faster.
Much faster.
So cheaper and faster, believe it or not. And this would evolve into a whole line of cameras. The next thing really to talk about is, what am I looking for here? I'm looking for this right here. This is the Apple QuickTake 100, be the first color consumer camera. It says Apple on it, but it's actually a Kodak product.
Mm-hmm.
They partnered up with Apple Computers. These were sold for about $700 to amateurs, fairly small image, 480-640 image, it'll hold about, I think it was 16 color. This was an application of Bruce Beyer's color filter array, which is pretty much how all digital...
That's the Beyer array.
Yep. Next year, Kodak came out with their own branded version, the DC40, and pretty much, again, what's in your pocket sort of evolves from that, and seeing where pointing at phones. Well, this is an interesting, this is one of those vaporware. This is a product that never happened. People always want to know, why can't I put a sensor into my camera?
That was my biggest question when the camera
started. Well, you could have, as a matter of fact.
We could have.
You could have. This is what everybody wanted. This is called silicon film. So instead of...
Can I just carefully hold
There
this?
You go. Really clever device.
I was so hoping for something like this back then, but it never materialized. You had it in the lab.
It was written about, yeah. It was talked about. Like a guy who left Kodak and really clever. It would sit where the film was, and there's a couple problems with this right off the bat. Is the sensor has to end up in the same place. Not all cameras internally are the same dimension. Yep. So this one is actually sized to fit either an Icon F3 or a FM2.
And the sensor size would have been a problem too.
Not so much. No, this is 2 megapixel. These were designed to sell for about $600 around.
Powering it?
There's little batteries in here. The problem was turning it on.
Yeah, well the thing has to know when the camera takes a picture.
Yeah, and the clever thing that it did, it had a sound gizmo that actually would recognize when the mirror starts to go up on an SLR. And you put it in here, you'll see it's got little contacts. This would go into the PCMCI slot in your computer. And even little, yeah, really, really cute. But, and again, these were, again, to sell for about $600. In 1999.
Who decided that it wasn't going to be a product?
They couldn't really get enough startup money to do this. The camera companies didn't want to do it because they wanted to sell you new cameras.
It would have allowed me to use my SLR a while longer.
For a while longer. But then we get into cell phones. It's certainly interesting. Cell phones had been around. This is the Nokia is the first sold in the U.S. And this is a camera phone. We actually would make really bad pictures with it. And it would evolve
for a while.
Yeah, this was one that I used. This was the Motorola E815. Again, it's not quite a megapixel. Trying to make you could make an okay bad image with this with a little bit of practice. Really, when you get into the original iPhone.
Really shows the development.
Again, of it, yeah.
Yeah.
So the iPhone, and of course, we all know today that whatever you've got in your pockets making probably something
That's
in the
success.
Vicinity of
12, yeah, 12,
12 megapixel
and good quality
and pretty good, yeah, surprisingly good quality. I actually shot a couple images while on vacation with some for some friends, and I made a print and gave it to them, and they didn't believe that it came out of my cell phone. I said, well, they can make really good pictures. One other thing that's really of interest, and people kind of lose track of this too, this guy right here. This is the Kodak EasyShare 1. It's a cute little camera, came out in 2004. This was the world's first Wi-Fi camera. That's the Wi-Fi card.
2004.
Yep.
So it was the card doing that.
Yeah, that's the Wi-Fi card.
Was that on like a, well, today it would be the EyeSight card.
Yeah. So you could take a picture and basically email it to your friends. Mm-hmm. Just like, of course, this is in 2004. Nobody else, why would you want a Wi-Fi camera?
No one had Wi-Fi.
But
well,
yeah,
not really.
Yeah. But again, early into the business. And also kind of another early into the business, Kodak came out with this guy right here. This is the MC3. This is a camera audio device from about 2000.
What do you mean camera audio device?
Well, it would play back music.
So it's an
MP3 Kodak
player.
iPod.
It's an MP3 player.
That's right, it's an MP3 player.
With a camera. Interesting choice.
Yep. A lot of engineers with interesting ideas. Too early to the market. People didn't understand why would I want to compress music and carry it with me.
Yeah, that someone else found out that
it's
got
to be it's got to be a vinyl record. You know, I need to have a big amplifier with tubes on it.
And now people like me are going back to film.
So, and I guess seeing we're talking back to film. We can talk about film a little bit right here. Yeah, well, he's dangerous.
Safety film.
Yeah.
Film that doesn't explode.
What most people don't realize about film, and this is just a small display of film that I put together over the years, film is actually the most complicated consumer product that's ever been manufactured.
I've had an interview with an ex Kodak employee. He made this book, Making Kodak Film.
Bob Shambrook. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. One of my good friends here.
And he's. I mean, I've looked into like the tens of layers of film and of stuff that makes this up.
This little yellow box makes it look so simple. Everybody's familiar with it. But really, what's in here represents hundreds of billions of dollars of research. Mm. Okay. You get into the manufacturing. All this stuff is made. In the feet per second, they're able to coat up to 24 layers simultaneously. They're made in...
In one go.
Yep.
And they are like micron thick.
Micron thick. And the quality control behind this is unbelievable.
It's amazing.
Like I said, it is by far the most complicated consumer product. And it's marketed so well that nobody realizes. Usually when you tell somebody that this is the most complicated product that's ever been made, they give you a look of disbelief. They think, you know, automobiles. But again, the quality to do this is just...
Oh, and the consistency.
Consistency. So it's the same every time. Yes. Or within, the tolerances are very, very thin, as you can do this in. And it's, you know, it's a product that evolved significantly over a period of years. I've come across an interview, a magazine interview with George Eastman in 1920, talking about forming the company. And he talks about sensitized material, selling film is a trust business. Mm-hmm. And he figured out very early on what he was talking about. In his first days of making dry plates, they would make them, and Anthony out of New York sold the plates. Now, Anthony wasn't rotating their stock. This is before they knew that film would age on the shelf. So by not rotating the stock, Anthony actually sold plates that were not light sensitive. It's not Eastman's fault, but he took it on himself to replace those plates because he was building a trust business. If you lose the trust, you're going to lose the business.
Oh. With pictures are memories, pictures are important.
That's right.
And if you look at what's on today's mobile phones, everyone is trying to do an as good as possible job to back that up, to save it, to never lose it. Yeah.
And when you buy film, you're actually buying the highest quality image at the time. Mm. In the case of whether you realize it or not, now when you buy a digital camera, at the time you're buying that camera, you've already decided how big that picture is going to be and what quality it's going to be. In the case of film,
the changes.
So a lot of decisions that are made with film were made by people who put hundreds of billions of dollars of research and innovation into it. In the case of your film, you're not covered. So in the old days, film people's kind of spoiled. You take pictures, get the prints, put them in a drawer, they kind of take care of themselves. You don't have to worry about maintaining it per se. Yeah, they'll last 100 years or whatever, with virtually no work on your part. Mm-hmm. In the case of your digital pictures, well, obviously ones and zeros are going to last forever. However, you have to be involved, or somebody will have to be involved in maintaining those, and maintaining not only the file, but also what's going to read the file and what you're going to play it back on. So it's an interesting time that we live in. The same folks that had trouble finding their digital word processing files 15 years ago or 20 years ago, you have to change your way of thinking.
I remember someone saying the last 100 years will be the least documented 100 years of mankind. I hope that's not going to be that way.
We have to have people who are vigilant enough to realize that we're taking care of, in this case, we're taking care of a fragile thing. In the case of digital things, we're taking care of you're taking care of an ether. There's nothing there. Yeah. You need something to play it back with.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, yes, it could last as long as the pyramids, as long as people take care of them, as long as you have to be an active participant now. And that's something that's hard to get across. And I have this conversation, people say, oh, I'll store it on the cloud. Well,
who is the cloud?
Where's the cloud? The cloud, somebody's got to maintain the clouds. Oh, by the way, your cloud just went bankrupt. So, it's better off, as much as you don't want to do it, you probably have to make up your own backups. And hopefully your children and their grandchildren will, because otherwise the images that are on your phone you'll lose when you go buy another phone, because they just went away. So, it's quite possible that the people who are growing up today will have almost no images of their childhood, unless there were prints that were made and on good quality paper good quality ink.
Big proponent of printing.
Yeah, printing. Yeah. So
getting stuff out.
There you go. The history of photography in a nutshell.
That was amazing, Todd. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Wow, what a cool place to be. So much history of photography. I want to really thank the Eastman House for letting us go into the technology vault. That was really good. And by the way, if you want to find out more, go to eastman.org or come to Rochester, have a visit. The museum is brilliant too. So I want to come back. I want to see more photography history. Thanks for being with us. Take care.